Innovation. It's a wonderful word, but we have a problem with it because it's everywhere. I'll give you 30 seconds on any company website before you hit the magic word. You know the kind of thing. Innovation, driving the business. Innovation, working for the customer. Innovation, innovation, it's everywhere. And these days in the public sector, it's the same thing. How do we solve our crisis? Innovation, innovation. Everybody's talking about innovation. And that's the problem. It's a great thing. It's really important. But what is it? And more importantly, what do we do with it? And that's what I want to talk about today. The challenge not just of saying innovation's important, but what might we do with it to make it create value for our organization? Here's a little map. You can see the way the axes work. As you go left to right, the world gets more uncertain. Now, I don't mind what you put there. That could be technological uncertainty. It could be market uncertainty, lots of competitors. Could be politics. Life just gets harder as you go left to right. Now, that vertical axis, how far could we get away with doing what we've always done? Now, I suggest if you put this map in front of anybody and say, okay, where's your organization on this map? They're going to say something like this. Don't be stupid. It's obvious the world's changing. We can't stand still. We've got to keep moving. That's what drives all those messages on the website, the need for continuous change. Maybe you have one or two who say, we understand. They don't. If we're clever, we could use this new technology or these new market conditions. We could create a whole new game. It's the kind of Harry Potter view of innovation, like magic. Now, that's fine. That's, of course, where you expect people to put themselves. It's our aspiration, our hope. We believe in innovation. The trouble is that for all sorts of reasons, just saying we believe in innovation, sometimes even putting money into innovation, may not be enough. For all sorts of reasons, organizations, even clever ones, can find themselves dragged below that line. So for me, and what I want to talk about today, the challenge is simple. We have to take innovation seriously, we have to make it happen, we have to manage it. Now, let me start then with a question to you. When did you last use your Spengler? Now, I think you all have a Spengler, and some of you might have touched yours recently. I can see worried faces in the room, so let me put you out of your misery. If I asked you when you last used your vacuum cleaner, your Hoover, Electrolux, Siemens, whoever brand you have, that's basically the question. Because it was somebody called Mr. J. Murray Spengler who invented and patented the electric vacuum suction sweeper. Nobody's ever heard of him. But if I were to say the word sewing machine, I think a name dropped into your head, which was probably Singer. Most people think Singer sewing machines. You'd all be wrong, because it was actually not Mr. Singer who invented the sewing machine, but a man who, again, nobody has heard of, called Elias Howe, who invented the sewing machine and went bankrupt. Mr. Singer bought the business. Now, these are two very small and silly examples, but they underline a really important point. Innovation is not like the cartoons. You know, in the cartoons, bing, a light bulb flashes on. That's not innovation. That's a bright idea, it's really a good start, but it's not necessarily enough. Innovation is about much more than just, bing, a bright idea. Here's some examples of bright ideas, some inventions, all of which the person who invented them believed were so important, they registered a patent. You'll find all of these in the US Patent Office. I don't see too many of them in the streets outside. For example, the famous gas-filled umbrella. Not many of them around. Interesting idea, but. The musical flamethrower. Little gadget here where you can go duck hunting if that's what you like to do. You can stay dry. You can't breathe, which is one of its drawbacks. I like this one. It's a little device to keep your unborn baby entertained for 9 months. It's a Walkman for the fetus. But my star prize would have to go to the genius who felt the world needed the cheese-flavoured cigarette. Ah, yes, of course. But they're silly examples. You've seen thousands of them on the internet. But they remind us, wacky inventions happen, people have bright ideas, they don't necessarily go anywhere. And that's the challenge in innovation. First of all, it's more than just an idea. We've got to do something with the idea. And that's part of a much bigger question, which is basically, what do we understand when someone says this word, innovation, to us? Now, there's the problem. How we think about something, our understanding of something, isn't just something we keep in our heads, it shapes what we do, what we pay attention to, what we give our resources to, what we manage. And so if our model of innovation is just, bing, it's bright ideas, that's what we'll pay attention to, that's what we'll support, that's what we'll manage. And we might do that really well, but all we'll have is lots of those crazy inventions. So we need to challenge ourselves as an organization and think about, what do we really understand by this word, innovation? And I'd suggest the problem is a bit like this. It's about partial models. It's a little like a child's jigsaw puzzle. There's nothing wrong with the piece that says invention is in there. We need good ideas, they're really important. But on its own, just saying we'll manage innovation by creating ideas isn't a good recipe. So here's a few more examples of pieces of this puzzle, all of which are important, but which on their own are not necessarily sufficient. For example, what we call the knowledge push idea. Now, this is very simple. Innovation is about knowledge. New knowledge, science, research, market research, new knowledge creates new possibilities. And so the idea of the knowledge push model is, let's spend a lot of resources creating new knowledge, and it will find its way somehow into something that creates value in the marketplace. And that's very persuasive, except that maybe the market doesn't want that wonderful stuff. The very famous quote in English from a writer called Ralph Emerson, who said, "Build a better mousetrap and the world will beat a path to your door." And they don't. There's a lot of bankrupt mousetrap salesmen around. The fact is, people have to want the thing, not because you believe it's great, but because they believe it's great. Okay, so then that says we need another piece of our jigsaw puzzle, which is about the market. Let's listen to the voice of the customer. Let the market pull the innovation through. That's got to be a good principle, except sometimes we get the condition where the market doesn't know what it wants. Famous Henry Ford quotation, "If I'd asked people what they wanted, they would have told me faster horses." Sometimes we can't imagine what comes next. And of course, in recent years, one of the great advocates of this view was Steve Jobs. His view was very much, people don't know they want this thing, but when they've got it in their hand, they won't understand how they ever lived without this wonderful thing. So, nothing wrong with any of those pieces. Bright ideas, create new knowledge, listen to the market. But on their own, each of them isn't enough. Put them together and we start to have the basis to manage innovation effectively and to keep on repeating the innovation trick. Here's a few more. For example, innovation's about technology. Now, I'm an engineer. I'm pretty dangerous these days in an oil refinery, but that's how I began life. And I love technology, I love gadgets, but that's not enough. Much of innovation isn't about technology, about computers and sensors and wonderful new machines. It's not just about that. It's about the way we do things, particularly in the service sector. It's about how human beings work together to create value and finding new ways of doing that. That's innovation as well, but if we believe it's just about the gadgets, the things, that's all we'll manage. And that may not be enough, that may not be the answer that we're looking for. So we need to think about managing innovation in terms of technology, but also the people around that technology. Another piece of the puzzle, it's about big change. That's the dramatic, exciting things about innovation. It's the stuff that hits the headlines, a completely new way of doing something, a product that's new to the world. Great, makes wonderful television. Unfortunately, the reality is rather different. I could bore you very quickly with the economic facts, Basically, what we've learned is most innovation, most of the time, is doing what we do a little bit better. It's nothing dramatic, it's incremental steps forward, but they add up. Now, there's a challenge here. If we're the chief executive and we want to appear on TV, we're going to say, this is important, the dramatic, radical innovation. But actually, the small stuff matters. So we need to think about managing not just the occasional flash of dramatic new stuff, but also this slow, steady pace of incremental improvement, doing what we do better. Another part of that challenge, who does the innovation? Now, I suggest many organizations have people who are licensed to innovate, like James Bond. They've got the badge. We're in new product development, new business areas. These are the people who are licensed to do innovation, and they're very good at their job. They're the ones from whom we expect innovation. But of course, the reality is that every single human being in our organization is capable of innovation. Look at any bunch of kids in a playground to remind yourself how creative human beings are. It's our natural gift. We can find and solve problems in new ways. So there's a big challenge here around innovation management. Do we mobilize all that potential or just license a few? And that's a big challenge. We do have quite a lot of evidence that where we take the time to engage everybody, it can bring big benefits. Particularly if most innovation is about small steps, continuous improvement, there's no reason why anybody can't contribute to that, whatever their role is in the organization. There are others we could talk about, but basically what I want to do is just to raise the question in our minds of how do we think about innovation? Because that will shape how we organize and manage it. Now there's some good news. Innovation is something that people like me have been studying for a long time. Basically, back in the 1900s, in 1908, at the MIT, the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, you'll find a paper that was published on technology management. How do we manage innovation? So for about 100 years, people have been looking at this question. And there have been all sorts of studies, almost all of them based on hard experience. This isn't a theoretical subject. We've learned what doesn't work as well as what works. So I'm now going to try and do the impossible. One picture, 2 minutes, I'm going to try and explain to you what we've learned about organizing and managing innovation. Well, message number one, it's not, bing, an event, a light bulb moment. It's a process. It's something that takes place over time, and it has this classic funneling shape, some kind of a wide mouth pointing to an arrow. And we know within that process, there are some key stages. And the first is searching for possibilities. Innovation is triggered in all sorts of ways. It may come from a research lab with lots of people in white coats. It may come from listening to the customers. What's their needs? It may come from watching the competitors and imitating them. Maybe the government tells us we can or can't do something. Maybe we have a bright idea in the shower. The message is clear. Innovation comes from all sorts of directions. So if we want to manage it, we've got to pick up those signals. Do we have rich antennae to pick up all those different signals? We have to search as widely as possible. But of course, that raises another challenge. We can't do everything. We don't have enough resources. So out of all the things we could do, which ones are we going to do and why? What I call strategic selection. And we want to get a balance between a few radical changes and a lot of this doing what we do better innovation. We've got to make it happen. The word looks simple, implementation, but to translate a bright idea to something that creates value in the marketplace or improves our processes, that takes time and effort. And it's not just about project management. It's also about managing risk and uncertainty. The thing with innovation is we don't know till we start whether it will work, whether the technology will work, whether that market actually is there. We only learn by starting and trying. So what we need to build on top of our project management are ways of reviewing and changing direction as we go along. So the big message and the big lesson we've learned is not just to say, that looks like a good idea, let's put some money into it and hope. What we have to do is keep reviewing as we take the projects forward. And this idea of managing the uncertainty, managing the risk, is a key feature about a well-organized innovation process. Now, there's lots of good tools, good messages around how we can do this, but essentially, point number one, we need to manage that innovation funnel. But there are things that affect the way that process works. In particular, do we have a clear idea of where we're going? Do we have an innovation strategy? Could we say, this is how making changes, making innovations happen, this is how innovation will move our organization forward? And do we communicate that so that everybody in the organization understands that's where we're trying to go and how my bright idea can help us get there? So we need an innovation strategy and a sense of direction and some leadership to take us into new and challenging territory, not just the space where everyone else is. The other thing about innovation is it's about people. As I said earlier, people are wonderful. They're naturally creative, they're full of knowledge and experience, they've got all the resources in their heads. Can we create the kind of space in which they can deploy that? They can share their ideas, they can try ideas out, they can talk to someone else and build on someone else's idea. Have we got the kind of organization where that feels like the way we do things around here? Or is it a kind of place where keep your head down, do as you're told, just keep doing what you're always supposed to do? In a sense, building the kind of culture that supports innovation is one of the really big challenges. And it's a simple one to express, quite hard to realize. How do we get people to do what comes naturally in the context of their workplace? This very ugly pink color is to remind us of another important piece in innovation, which is it's not a solo act. A lot of research on innovation has shown many, many times it's about talking to different people. This is not a new idea, but in the 21st century, when there is so much knowledge around in terms of technology, when our marketplace is now really global, when we're talking about 7 billion people in a marketplace, all of this, they're strands of what I call knowledge spaghetti. And what we really have to recognize is not all the smart people work here. We need to start thinking about making connections out there, building new kinds of links. One of the big changes between the 20th and the 21st century is innovation moves from thinking about the organization to thinking about networks and making connections. So managing this becomes a really important part of the puzzle. But there's one other piece I want to mention, which is perhaps the most important. No organization starts with a perfect one of these. Do we learn? Do we step back and try and develop our ways of managing innovation? Nobody starts with a perfect one of these. You learn over time. You adapt and change things. Some things work, some things don't, but you learn to manage innovation more and more effectively. And really that boils down to five questions any smart organization should ask itself and keep asking itself. First one, do we have that enabling process? Do we have mechanisms to translate ideas, possibilities, market research, technology? Do we have ways of picking up those signals and creating value from them? Have we got a process or are we just gambling? Have we got a strategy? Do we have some sense of direction? Are we clear how innovation is going to take us forward? And do we share that so that everyone in the organization understands where and how innovation can take us forward? Is this the kind of place where people can do what comes naturally, where they can be creative, where they can share and build on the ideas of others, where the culture, the way we do things around here, is all about innovation and creativity? Do we have those rich links out into external networks, and do we build and extend them proactively? And really importantly, do we learn? Do we stop, reflect, and tune and adapt our model to make it better and better to cope with a world out there that's constantly changing? Five really big questions which any organization that's serious about innovation should reflect on. That's the model. There's lots underpinning it. The good news, as I say, is we've learned a lot, and there are many tools and techniques and frameworks to help us do all of this. But it will only happen if we're prepared to step back and think about, discuss, and develop our version of this model for managing innovation. So let me now summarize the journey that we've been on over the last 15 minutes. First of all, innovation matters. This is not just a Friday afternoon interesting topic. It's about survival and growth. Quite simply, if we don't change what we offer the world and the ways we create and deliver that, we may not be around. There's very good evidence most organizations don't last as long as a human being. Hella is already exceptional. It's over 100 years old. It's a great example of an organization that has changed and adapted to survive. It's all about innovation. And I have to say, I think it's a wonderful and very innovative company. So innovation does matter. We should take it seriously. That means we've got to actively manage it, not just say, it's important, we believe in it. We have to do something about it. Trouble is that the world keeps changing. Technologies change, markets change, politics change. The trouble is that whilst the old problem of innovation is the same, how do we create value from ideas? The context in which that happens is constantly changing. So we need not just to have the capability to manage it, but the ability to step back and adapt and change that capability, what we academics call dynamic capability. And what that translates to in the real world is, of the things we do, which ones should we do more of? They really work. They help us with our innovation. Of the things we do, which ones may have been good in the past, but perhaps we should stop doing, or at least do less of them? And in a world that's changing very fast, what new tricks do we have to learn to add to our repertoire? So it's all about learning new tricks. It's all about learning. So perhaps I could leave the last word to this gentleman here. Now, you may not recognize him, but if you're a fan of children's stories, you might. This is Winnie the Pooh. You may have seen the Walt Disney version, but the original one, which comes from 1917, actually looks like this wonderful picture. More important though, if you open the very first page of the very first book called Winnie the Pooh, you get a very interesting message about the problem of learning. Here we have Edward Bear, that was his proper name, coming downstairs now, bump, bump, bump on the back of his head behind Christopher Robin, which is, as far as he knows, the only way of coming downstairs, except that sometimes he feels there really is another way, if only he could stop bumping to think of it. That really captures it. Organizations aren't stupid. They do want to learn. It's just very difficult to get away from the day-to-day crisis, the bumping of our heads, the fighting of the fires. It's very difficult to get away, step back and think, how might we do this better? I hope this little brief introduction to innovation gives you some food for thought and helps you with that process, not so much bumping your heads as thinking about how could we manage innovation more effectively. Thank you.